everybody. I am so excited to have you all back with us for our Parenting on the Go series with our session in episode number 2. Today, I am lucky to have with us Wendy Snyder, who is a positive parenting coach, as well as a family life coach and educator. Wendy, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
Yay, I'm so excited to talk to you because when we talked a little bit before, one of the things that I know that you are an expert in and have so much knowledge in is compassionate discipline. And that was not something I had ever heard of before. And so I would love if you could just sort of share with others what that is, because I think it's so interesting.
Yeah. So compassionate discipline, I like to describe it as you have a mindset to teach, to mentor. And with our children, we constantly have the opportunity to teach life skills instead of traditional punishment is kind of based in retribution and making kids pay the price for what they've done in the past. Whereas discipline is more rooted in mentorship and teaching life skills that have to do with helping them make different future decisions. And then as far as the compassionate part of it goes, when we do it with connection, we just have much better outcome as far as sustainability when it comes to results with our kids.
That definitely makes sense. You know, I have a 2.5-year-old, and so we are just starting to sort of really tiptoe into the waters of what discipline can be at home and sort of how to set up expectations and how to set up boundaries and really help to guide her. And it's definitely can be a challenge sometimes, especially with, you know, when some of the boundaries we want to set up are not exactly aligned with what the things she wants, and temper tantrums ensue. And so I really, when you brought this up, I love the relationship side of what you're talking about with compassionate discipline. And I guess what I'm wondering is, you know, at the museum, we believe so strongly in that you can learn through play. And so I'm wondering, is there an opportunity for play to be integrated at all in this sort of discipline strategy? And how can that happen?
Absolutely. So play is actually the best way. Whenever we can incorporate play into our parenting, kids are going to learn so much better. They will actually, you know, start to hang out in that rational thinking part of their brain where they accept our lessons a lot better than if they feel like they're, you know, the traditional approach is like that more punishment side of things, where oftentimes kids, once they feel like there's danger, like whether it's fear of a consequence or fear that mom and dad are going to get mad or something's going to get taken away, that amygdala lights up and then they just aren't going to be able to learn the lesson like we want them to. So staying with them and having them kind of hang out in that rational part by engaging them in play is such a fantastic way. So there's a few ways you can do this. And what I want to encourage parents to understand though is that so positive parenting is not about being permissive. It's actually about being very strong with our boundaries and our roles. And then, like I said, doing it with connection and compassion and teaching important life skills and sticking to the strong boundaries. So I like to teach in like a cookie format. And then I always say, kids love cookies.
I love cookies and I love metaphors, so I'm ready for it.
I love acronyms. I love cookies. Yes. Yeah. I have so many different acronyms for families in my programs. But the cookie one is you have a strong boundary and then you're going to use connection and mentorship and then follow through with that strong boundary. So in your case, if you have a 2.5-year-old, then maybe, you know, you don't want her climbing on furniture, or like, what do you have an example of something that might be going on in your house where you're like, no, this is a strong boundary. Like you can't pull the dog's tail or.
I was just going to say, we have a dog. We also actually have chickens at our house. So we're really trying to teach what are okay kind of ways to touch animals and what are not, and kind of make that really clear so that it can be safe.
Okay. So here's a great example. I think listeners love specific examples. So the cookie looks like very strong boundary. Like you see her pulling the chicken's feathers out or whatever it is. And it's like, hey, I will not allow you to pull the chicken's feathers out. And you're learning self-control when you're curious around animals. That's the connection piece. Okay. Of course you want to pull those feathers. They're soft. They feel good. Right. Like you love these chickens. And mentorship, I'm going to teach you how to pet the chickens nicely. I'm going to actually teach you how to hold the chickens so they feel safe and they don't get hurt. And I will not allow you to pull out the chicken's feathers. Like that's what the example of the cookie looks like. And then when it comes to that mentorship piece, when you heard me say, I'm going to teach you how to hold the chicken.
Yes.
then that's where you can bring in the play.
Okay.
Now remember, so kids, when they are like lit up, so any type of, when we are lit up with emotions and like, you know, whether it's fire coming out of our head or just general upset, we can't be good teachers. So we always want to teach in a calm time. But one of the three biggest kind of compassionate discipline tools that we teach families to stock in their toolkit, one of them is logical consequences and natural. Okay. Logical consequences, self-calming and natural consequences. And within logical consequences, there's a lot you can do to teach with what we call the four R's. It's related, it teaches responsibility, it's reasonable, and it's respectful. So one of those logical consequences that you can do is role plays or redos. And with role plays, you can bring in puppets, you can bring in matchbox cars, you can bring in dolls, you can whatever, like bath toys is a great example.
Yes.
And then what I have families do is they practice what it looks like to like make the mistake, pull the feathers out, and then the chicken bath toy or, you know, the pig bath toy is like crying and mom got upset because she ended up yelling and like everyone was crying. Like this little doggy toy ended up having a meltdown and then like it was just a really hard day and everyone's like in the bath and they're like, that like they act it out. And it's like, that was hard for the chicken. And then you can say as a parent, well, let's redo it and see if the doggy can practice holding the chicken like underneath its wings so it feels safe and keeping her hands like, you know, petting the chicken respectfully.
Yes, in secret,
and then, and then your little girl, you would practice with her and she would practice coming over and holding the chicken doll or whatever it was, or you can pretend anything, the chicken, right?
Yeah.
and then after the end, you get to ask them like, oh, how did that feel? Like, how did you do that? How did you keep yourself control, Mr. Doggy? Like, cause I bet you were tempted to pull that chicken feather out and the doggy gets to go, I was tempted and I did it. Yeah. Right. And like, so the key thing that I want here parents to understand is practice makes progress, not perfection, but practice is the key. Okay. Like Olympic athletes don't win downhill races by doing things like five times. They practice over and over and over again. And so practice a lot. And if they still keep making the mistake or having the misbehavior, practice more, make it more fun because play will connect you. And role plays is one of my favorite ways to do that.
I love that. And that's, it makes so much sense. So my little girl has a dollhouse. And you know, I often see her using the dolls to kind of reenact, you know, very kind of common scenes that are in her house. So we're going to make dinner and she has them act out, but it definitely makes sense that you know, that's how she's learning what everyday behaviors are. And so I've never really thought to sort of translate that into like a more intentional sort of discipline behavior scene. And that totally makes sense for something that she could then sort of herself reenact and herself start to think through as she's playing with her different toys and things. So I really love that idea.
Well, I'll give you one more example. I had a Bonfire member. So I have an online course called the Foundations Course. And then I have an online membership program called the Bonfire. And we have families from all over the world now. It's the coolest thing. What families realize is we all have the same challenges in our house, no matter where you live.
It's universal.
If you are raising human little souls. So anyways, this Bonfire member, I forget where she is. I think she's in Europe somewhere. But she shared this video of her little girl, which was 3 years old.
Okay.
And she walked into the room and she noticed that she was on the ground playing with her toys. And she heard her start talking about what win-win. And she started filming. And a win-win is something we teach families. So we teach parents how to do this. We teach kids how to do this. But it basically is a very simple, peaceful conflict resolution strategy where two humans next to each other say, I feel blank. I want blank. How are we going to make this work for both of us? Okay. And the people take turns. And she had been actively kind of practicing that in her home as a mom and then teaching her little girl how to do that too. So she walked in one day and her little girl had these toys on the ground. And she says in the video, she says, what are you doing, honey? And she goes, oh, we're just playing win-win. And she goes, She goes, oh, what happened? She goes, well, Hippo, in this sweet little three-year-old voice, she goes, well, Hippo stepped on my toes. And I told him, like, I'm not okay with that. And I feel sad when you step on my toes. And Hippo was like, and her mom was just like, oh my gosh. And so practicing negotiation at the age of 3 years old. She was also practicing how to speak up for herself.
Right.
For what she wants. I'm asking Hippo to keep his feet to himself. Mm-hmm. Like, it was just the most beautiful, mind-blowing video. One of my favorite videos of my
life. That sounds amazing. And I love that, because one of my like favorite quotes is that I'm probably going to butcher the quote a little bit, but it's play is hard work, right? For little kids, because it is sort of that idea where they're really just sort of like trying to master different skills by exploring things like their, you know, whether it's their dolls or their hippos or whatever it is. And so I love that the way that you connect that is that it's practice for them, right? It's like practice of these skills, and it's those verbal skills of communication that are so important for helping kids, especially when they're little, navigate big feelings and navigate, you know, what's often sort of the like catalyst for needing to have some discipline in place or, you know, different boundaries in place. So I haven't necessarily thought of what my daughter's been doing as practice when she's doing, you know, her little dollhouse reenactments or anything like that. But I love the idea of giving her sort of the language and the tools to set her up to practice even when I'm not there. So that's really, I really love that as just like a tip and a technique to try at home.
And I mean, the list could go on for a long time about what they're practicing. They're practicing empathy, they're practicing creativity, they're practicing imagination.
Right.
They're practicing so much that when it comes to like humans learning how to make like healthy decisions in life around behavior and how to have healthy relationships, like it takes practice, right? Like, so they get to, they're actually doing all those things. Like empathy is probably not one you think of, but like
that
little girl in that role play, she was probably sitting there thinking, cause she's been mentored by her mom,
right?
And they're thinking like, why did Hippo step on her toes? Like what could be going on for Hippo? Like,
And like, you know, thinking through like the other, that's really amazing. And I also just am so impressed because this is a strategy that like, she's three, right? My daughter's 2.5. And I think sometimes with the youngest little people, I think sometimes people are hesitant to think that they can take on those kinds of strategies and emotions because of their age. And they're still, you know, developing so many language skills, but it is something that, you know, it's practice for them. And so setting up that model for them and allowing them the tools to practice that only will make them more fluent in it as they are older, you know, when they're 5 and 6 and starting to be school aged with other kids. So I think that that is just really wonderful that this is also a strategy that can be used with almost any age, it sounds like, of child.
Yes, it is never too young.
Yeah. Like I
would say, you know, kids, like the really little ones, we think that they can't, you know, process so much, but really I always give the analogy of like, you know, if you say you're like, you all speak Spanish in your house. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, your baby's growing up, he's growing up. And then all of a sudden one day at like 1.5 years, he starts speaking. Or like, you know how like around 2, sometimes they like really take off and they start speaking.
So many words. Yes.
That happened on, we have a block where we have so many kids. And one day it's like, the baby is like a toddler. I'm like, you're talking now? But when they start talking, like if they've grown up in a pretty much, you know, first language Spanish, speaking home, they're not going to start speaking English. They're going to start speaking Spanish.
Right.
Or like same, like if you grew up in an English speaking home, like you're not going to start speaking French. So that we have to remember that everything that we're teaching, everything that we're modeling, like every little bath toy, little situation that we do when we clean up, like a sibling fight, like they are processing it. They are. And then one day they have the skills to like start doing it themselves, but it doesn't you don't need to wait until they're older and then you teach, like have them be part of their, like just kind of their DNA.
Yeah. Well, I like that analogy too, of almost thinking of language and behaviors of behaviors and emotions, almost like a language, right? It's like you're teaching them the language of emotions. You're teaching them the language of the behaviors that you want them to practice. And, they can practice that through their play, through their bath toys, or, you know, through whatever it is that they have at home. I think that that's really wonderful. You know, as I'm thinking about this, Wendy, are there any other sort of benefits that you have found with integrating play into compassionate discipline? Has there been anything that like play in particular is just really, really wonderful for when parents are sort of working towards helping kiddos, you know, have a more positive sort of moment or, you know, strategies for their lives?
Absolutely. So there's a gazillion, but one of them that comes to mind is the whole movement thing. Like the number one way to have your kid resist your discipline.
Oh yeah.
Is to sit them down and say, yep. Look in my eyes, look at me.
Yeah.
It is not okay to do X, Y, and Z, or you'll just lose them. So
yeah.
Again, incorporate play. So my little guy is sitting here with me right now. He's 10 now, but, and actually this is the same with my daughter, because both of my kids and so many listeners right now or people that are watching have kinesthetic kids. That means they are kids that love to jump, run, you know, kick, bike. Like they often learn through doing. And if you sit them still, like, and you make them sit down, especially this is often like very common for boys, like they're, when they sit down, like they have like kind of sometimes the learning centers will shut down, but when they're moving. So for example, with my little guy who's here with me, a few weeks ago, we needed to work on something. We needed to do some life learning together. Mm-hmm. And so my husband went down to the field with him and they threw the football back and forth. Yeah. And the lesson that needed to be taught and the discussion, the compassionate discipline, so to speak, went really, really well. And so even if you have like a rocking chair that you make into like a talking chair, like, you know, anytime you're even if you sit down with your kids and you give them like some Play-Doh or some kinesthetic sand to like movement can just be very soothing and calming for kids. And then you're connecting with them over the activity, the play, not over the lesson that they need to learn, because they will just be like, this is lame. I'm out of here.
That's such a wonderful way to think about it. You know, I actually am a person who, I have like fidgets. So things that I have to sort of, you know, play around with as I'm doing my own thinking, because it just helps my mind to sort of concentrate on a task as opposed to sort of what I'm trying to process. And so it makes sense that, you know, for any age kiddo, whatever, I love the phrase that you used of life learning that you guys had to do, you know, whatever life learning is that you need to do together to do while you're, to teach it while you're playing, right? It's, you know, you can be doing this activity that's really fun, and, but you can still be sort of imparting different ideas to them as you're talking and playing, because they're, you know, mind is working on this, but you're also helping them process what might be a bigger kind of life understanding. So that's so wonderful. I'm definitely going to steal that. And I'm definitely going to sort of try it on, you know, next time we're doing some Play-Doh or that kind of thing, or there's a really a moment that my little one and I need to chat. I think that's a great tip.
Yeah. I have even a example that comes to mind for that one. I have a dear friend who's a Montessori teacher. He's a beautiful school here in Encinitas. And I remember him telling me the story one time of, he had a kiddo that was having trouble learning math, because we're talking about learning lessons, right? Whether it's schoolwork or life lessons that we're teaching as a parent when we need to discipline. But he said he was having so much trouble learning math, and they had taken him to tutors, and, you know, everyone was just like, what's wrong with him? What's wrong with him? And Larry got him in his care, and he decided to empower him to create a game somehow around football, and somehow he incorporated the math lesson into like, hey, like, let's create a game and see if we can, I don't know what it was. And he said it was like magic. Like the kid the next week was like flat, like acing test, and just completely comprehending the concepts, because he had been engaged with like some type of play that interested him. And then they were able to incorporate the lessons into it too.
Yeah, I think that's a really kind of great final point too. It's just that play is interesting for kids. Like that's their work and that's what they find engaging. And so as much as we can kind of leverage that, I feel like as parents and caregivers, to really help us also incorporate, you know, different discipline techniques we need, or whatever the life learning is, whether it's math or reading or, you know, just how to be kind to others. I think that that is so amazing to think through, that like play really can be such a vehicle for so much for little kids. So I definitely have some tips I know that I will be trying on. We're probably going to do a couple little chicken reenactments at our house. Just have to find just the right puppet. But I super appreciate you talking with us today, Wendy. I've learned so much. I hope everyone else out there has learned so much too. This has been so wonderful. Thank you for speaking with us today. It's been great to learn all about compassionate discipline and all about how play can be utilized with it.
Yay! Yes, it's been so nice being here. And I have a free guide I would love to give your listeners. Yeah, it's all about raising strong-willed kids with integrity. So everything that we're talking about today is like, you know, it's great. And I know, because I have one, I've been blessed with one, that if you have one of these wonderful, strong-willed kids that just seems to have a little extra oomph in the no department, you know, get yourself supported with some extra support, because it just will really help. So freshstartfamilyonline.com/strong-willed kids to grab that free guide.
Perfect. We'll make sure that we put that in the comments so everybody can kind of figure out how to navigate and find that free resource. So thank you so much, Wendy. Thank you guys, everybody, for joining us, and we'll see you next time.